सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई विल गिव यू अ कैलकुलेटर.
नो आई वांट यू टू राइट अ मीन्स टू बिल्ड अ सॉफ्टवेयर फॉर मी.
So
We
we
will write a
can put
program.
it with PLI, like we can write a program and take inputs.
Yes, so how you will start? What you will do?
We will write a program in using some language.
Okay. So fine. So then you will write a program. So for writing a program, will you do anything or you will simply start writing a program?
Sir, I will ask the input numbers range.
Okay. No, what I am asking is that before you write the program, will you do anything? Or you will simply start writing a program for adding two numbers.
Just start writing a program, I think. So
Okay,
we will
so
open
you'll
a text
start writing a
editor.
program. Fine, that is fine. So, yes, that is anyway part of writing the program. So you will require an editor to write it. That is fine. But apart from writing the program, is there anything involved for planning for the program?
Yeah, like where to find where to get the input from, like in the either in the command line or while executing the program or either explicitly asking for inputs, something like that. What is the
Okay.
interface mean?
Okay. Fine. And can you quickly tell me, means only the main part, what will be the program?
So we'll just
Say
take
you
two output and
assume
we
C
add
syntax.
them and print it out as the output.
So assume C, and can you quickly tell me the lines of the code?
Sir, int A, I'll declare two integers A and B, and then I'll take input using scanf, and then I'll prompt the user to enter the numbers using scanf, and then I'll take the input. I'll add the input and then display the input on the command line using printf.
Right, so there will be two integers defined, int A, B, and there
Yes,
will be
sir.
a scanf
Yes, sir.
statement and then printf statement. Okay, so here now A, B, so you are using the names of the variables as A, B. So can you do anything better?
For naming the variables, you mean?
Yes.
We may use num1, num2.
Sorry? Say again.
Sir,
We can include the variable names, like num1
Num1, num. Okay. Fine. So why you want num1 and num2 and not A and B?
because they are more
to simplify
readable.
the core understanding.
Understanding of whom?
To simplify the understanding of code for some external user to read.
So when others read the code, they can understand by reading the code that these are two numbers.
So who will read your code?
The teammates maybe.
Okay, maybe some other developer. Fine. So, right. So these are some of the issues that I want to highlight. One is whether you need to plan before you write, and then what you need to follow while you write the code. Now, that is one thing. So these are the issues. Now, suppose instead of simply an adder, I want a full-fledged calculator, which will involve addition, subtraction, division, multiplication, all functions. Will you do anything different while writing a program for this?
Yes, first of all, I will break it into the parts, like design an adder, subtractor and etc.
Break it into parts, right? So what do you mean by that? Can you elaborate?
Let's say if the user wants to add two numbers, then I would use the part in which I wrote the adding code, and then I will use that part of the function, that part of the code. Like, let's say if he wants to add two numbers, then I will use the part in which the adder is mentioned. Like the adder is there written. Like, you know, if we need to break the calculator into the parts, we cannot just write that like in one single code. That would be clumsy.
So when you say you need to break into parts, how you decide on the parts? Depending on the functions that it supports?
Then maybe we'll take a survey of what all functions the calculator should have, then implement.
So each function will be implemented as a part of the code. Is that what you are saying?
Yes, sir. Sure. Why not?
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Now, suppose I want you to build a spreadsheet, say MS Excel or similar things. What you will do?
Sir, we will like take note of
first of all. I think
2-3 persons are speaking, or there is some noise. So one at a time. So yes, go ahead.
I will study the features of the Excel sheet first of all, the spreadsheet. What are the features?
Okay.
And then I will try to break that into the parts, and then I will code it.
So first you will study the features. You will study the features, or you will try to identify the features? Which one you will do?
Yeah, exactly. Like identify, first of all, identify, and then separate the ones which would be needed, by the user.
Okay, so there are two things. One is trying to identify the features, and then identifying only a subset of those features which will be needed by the users. So you want to do both. Now, any idea how you can do that?
Ask the user simply, like what the user wants.
Okay, fine. And then?
Study about that features, like what that feature do, and how we want it to interact with the user, and then code it.
No, how you study what the features do?
Like internet.
Internet.
Yes, I will ask the user to elaborate the feature, and then once I get the thing, then I will
code it. So you mean the user will tell you what to do, and then you will simply write the program?
No, I mean like I will ask him what he thinks it should be like. I don't want the user to be unsatisfied with my product.
Okay, so now you have introduced another very interesting term. You don't want the user to be unsatisfied. So according to you, you will ask the user what they want, and if they say I want so and so, then you will just write it, and then you feel that the user will be satisfied with that. Is that what you are saying?
Yes, I will try my level best to provide whatever he wants.
So tell me one feature of a spreadsheet tool. So I think you have used probably MS Excel, right? Or any yes. spreadsheet have you used?
I have used MS Excel only. I have not worked with spreadsheets a lot.
No, that is fine. Excel is one kind of spreadsheet. So now tell me one feature that you have used.
We can add the entries. Like we want to get the total strength of a school, and in the spreadsheet is like class one have so and so students, class two have so and so students, and we want to get the total strength of the school. So we can directly add those entries.
Okay. So suppose I want to create a database of the students in a class, and then want to calculate the average using a spreadsheet tool, average marks of the students in the class using a spreadsheet tool. Suppose I as a user want such a feature in the tool that you are going to sell me. What do you expect me to tell? So that you can write
I would want the marks of each student and the total strength. Yes, like I would want the marks of each student. Like
no, so as a user, I will provide you the marks, names, age.
Yes, I need the data.
For things, but then that has nothing to do with the code. So now you said that you will want to satisfy the user. Okay, so. If I simply tell you that I want this particular option or feature in my tool, how you are going to do it? Give me an idea.
First we would need an adder, like we would add all the marks and then we would divide it by the total strength of the
class. No, one by one. First, you need to provide a facility for the user to input the data, right?
Oh, okay. Yes.
So how do you think it should be done?
On a console, or on some
voice command? How?
He can type it on the interface.
So you will provide an interface?
Yes.
What would be that interface? What it will look like?
That's the that is the job of designer. That is, I don't think that is my job.
Okay, fine. So then if the interface is not good, then how you will ensure that if your code will satisfy the user? Suppose the designers have given a very bad interface, but if eventually have written a code for it. But then how you will ensure that your code will satisfy?
I will, actually, I am the user to the designer. So designer need to satisfy me first, and then I will show the final product to the main user.
So designer needs to satisfy the developer, means you as a developer. Yeah. I am you as a developer. So designer needs to satisfy the developer or the user, end user.
It is one and the same thing, I guess. Like, if the user is satisfied, then I am satisfied.
No, the end user. So first thing we should keep in mind is that the end user and the developer are two separate things, separate concepts. So
yes.
You have correctly said that your job means focus should be to satisfy the user. That means the end user. So not the developer or team members. Okay, so that is the first thing. In any case, so I think we are getting the point that there are lots of confusions. What exactly needs to be done? Because spreadsheet tool is a big thing, unlike an adder, where things are very straightforward. We have only limited options and limited things to code. But in case of a spreadsheet, it is not that simple. And there are a lot of things. So in such case, we cannot simply start writing a code assuming that everything will be based on only the code. So there are many other things also, which we first need to take care of. So we should keep in mind the difference between a simple program and a product. Program is typically the small programs like adders, small codes. Typically thousands of lines. Product, large and complex systems involving, say, hundreds of thousands or millions of lines of codes. Now, as many of you said, when I ask you to build an adder, you will simply start writing a program. So that is called exploratory style of programming. That is, we start by writing the program. Think in terms of coding. And we keep on coding as we try to solve the problem. Now, this exploratory style has its merits, of course. But when we are dealing with small codes, it is all right. It may be all right. But when we are dealing with products or large complex systems, this exploratory style will lead us to nowhere. We will be lost. What to do next? Instead, what we can do is we can plan the whole development as a sequence of well-defined stages of development. Now, each of these stages are there to take care of a specific aspect of the development. And it is not necessary that a single person or single team take care of all the stages. So there may be different teams, like somebody just mentioned that interface design is part of designers. Maybe. So it can be part of a stage where designers are involved. But overall, when we are thinking of a product, a software product, then we have to think of the whole development as comprising of stages performed in sequence. Now, why we need to perform these stages in sequence, and why we need to think of development as this sequence of stages? The main reason, as already somebody pointed out, is that it should be easy to maintain. First of all, maintain by different teams. That means it should be easy to communicate the designs between teams. It should be easy to understand the codes developed by one team so that other team can test it or augment it. And also, as again somebody pointed out, it is expected that if we follow systematic stage-wise development process, then it will eventually lead to customer satisfaction. Now, later on, we'll differentiate between two terms, customer and end users, or clients and end users. That will come later. So the key concerns here are modularity, that is dividing the whole process into whole product into modules or components, and design and development of those modules individually and then integrating them together to build the whole system in the form of a sequence of stages, which popularly is known as life cycle of a product, which includes, of course, deployment and maintenance of the product as well. So in this course, we learned that how to build products, what are the stages involved, and how to take care of those stages. Again, I want to emphasize that all these stages need not be taken care of by the same, by a single person or team. There may be different teams, but it is always useful to learn about those stages. And we learn about those stages in this course. So we learn about different life cycle models. Then we learn about stages like feasibility study, requirement specification, requirement analysis and specification, design of the system, prototyping for quick evaluation, coding, writing codes to implement the components of the system and the whole system, code testing, as well as other sorts of testings that we will learn, and some idea of overall project management, cost estimation, etc., towards the end of this course. These are broadly the stages, but of course, we will have more refined stages when we discuss the actual life cycles. Now, here you can see that in the stages that I mentioned, coding is only one stage. It is not the whole thing. In fact, non-coding related activities comprises major portion of a software development life cycle. So we should not think of building a software as only involving coding. It involves lots of other things before and after coding, which we'll learn in this course, along with, of course, something on coding. But coding anyway, all of you know very well, so we'll not spend much time on how to write good codes. Only few guidelines we'll discuss. But our main focus will be the other stages, so that you have a comprehensive knowledge of how a software is built. Now, this course involves theory and lab, so we'll follow this distribution. Now, here some modifications are there. So this is last year's policy. Now this year we will follow a slightly different one. So there will not be periodic evaluations, but two exams, mid-sem, end-sem, plus one or two quizzes. So total maximum four and minimum three exams will be there, which will constitute 25%. Now I will try to make the class, I'll try to encourage you to interact more. I like to have the class interactive, and we will note down the names of those who are interacting more, and this interaction will carry certain weight, 25%. So try to interact more. Those who will interact will be awarded this percent of marks. Now, theory grade will be determined based on exams and interaction. Lab grade will be project plus interaction. And you are expected to attend the classes. But here, unlike last year, this time I am planning to use a mix of different modes of teaching. So sometimes I will deliver lectures, sometimes I will share the lecture slides with you, and in live session you are expected to get clarifications on the points covered in the slides. So that is flipped mode. So I will use a mixture of both. And in that flip mode, you are expected to interact so that you can earn extra marks. That is briefly the grading policy that I am likely to follow. You can use any book on software engineering. I will actually cover interactive software engineering lifecycle. So some portion of it will be taken from the book I have written. So you can follow that if you have a copy. Otherwise, any standard software engineering will cover most part. Any standard book on software engineering like Pressman or Rajiv Mal. And you can follow my NPTEL lectures also. I will provide links whenever suitable so that you can follow. And this, as I said, I will share slides in flip mode so that you can go through it. Some of you have already taken my elective last semester. So for them, some portion will be anyway repetition because I'm going to cover that same life cycle again, but there will be many new material as well. Okay, that is briefly what I am going to do in this course and what you can expect from this course. Now, let me hear if you have any queries.
Sir, I have a query.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, in this course, there are more than 100 students registered and even attending right now. So, sir, do you have any fair system of interaction? Because it will be quite tough if there are more than 5-10 speaking at a time. Or that is my only genuine concern. Like whoever shouts the first, is that counting as interaction?
Or? No, we'll not do in that way. I will ask those who wants to interact to raise hand first. So there is a feature, raise hand. Then I will call out name one by one. And typically my experience is that not everybody wants to interact. So let us see for first few classes how many wants to interact and if there is any problem.
Okay.
Then we'll modify.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Sir, I have a general concern of attaching rewards for interacting. I mean, if most of the cases when there are marks for interacting, people try to interact more and like put in less useful question and such. So can you think of some other way of like increasing interaction?
No. Why you think so? Means if you are interacting with some gibberish, of course that I can make out. No, so you need not worry about that.
This happened in the number theory course of our third semester, I believe.
No, I don't care about other courses. I know what I am talking about, so I will follow this.
Okay, sir.
So if you are interacting with genuine intent, be sure you will get good marks. If you feel that others are interacting just for the sake of interaction, you need not worry. I can make that out.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have a query. How is the attendance counted? Means you have to attend in first 5 minutes or you have to present in the class for 45 minutes or how is it counted, attendance?
Well, so teams provide this attendance registration system. So we'll download it occasionally in between the classes to see whether everybody is logged in. And randomly I can call out if time permits to see whether actually somebody is really present or not, or simply logged in and left. So you are expected to be logged in and attend.
Thank you, sir.
But I will mostly rely on this Teams feature, attendance recording feature.
Sir, I think it notes the timestamps of entering the meeting and leaving the meeting. So many a time students leave the meeting in between as well because of internet issues and rejoin again. So will it be a random snapshot during any point of the lecture?
Because of this online problem, so that is why I kept this interaction feature on. I mean, interaction component. So even if you are unable to attend for your network issues, so during the duration of the course, if you have interacted, you have asked relevant questions or interacted meaningfully, you should not worry. Attendance will be taken care of.
Okay.
Sir, can you provide NPTEL content before the lectures?
Yes. I will send the links beforehand, and then that will be in the flipped mode. So you can watch it anytime you wish. And then during this class hour, we will come for live interaction sessions where you can put in your queries if you have any for clarification.
Okay.
Sir, any more information about lab sessions? When will the lab session be, weekly or?
So now what we'll do is we'll probably share a form where you have to put in. We'll use, we'll form teams of, say, now I think total 113 students are registered. So probably we'll go with 4-member teams, and one team will have 5-member. So there will be total 28 teams as per the registration record as of today. Now we'll share some form where you will put in your team details. So try form teams of 4 members. Once that is formed, then I will ask you to come up with project ideas, whichever you wish. And you will be asked to implement that in a stage-by-stage manner. Whichever stages will be learning in the theory part. Is that clear?
And sir, will you be giving same grade for lab and the theory course?
Same grade for?
I mean, you mentioned in a previous slide that lab and theory course both will be marked together. So does that mean we'll receive the same grade for both of them?
See, if you perform very poorly in the exams but do very well in the lab, then lab grade will be more than theory. That is expected.
Sure. Thank you.
Any other question? Okay,
sir,
then I think.
Sir, would the slides be shared with us after the class?
Sorry?
Would the slides be shared?
Which slides?
The slides which you are using for teaching.
Yes, I can share that. No issue.
Okay.
In fact, that is what I just said, that I will follow this flip mode also, where I will beforehand share the slides, and during this class hour, I will not deliver any lecture. Instead, you are expected to go through the slides, and if you have queries, you can get those clarified during the interaction session.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So I think I can stop sharing. Right, so if there is no more question, then we can stop today here. And tomorrow we'll not have any class, so I have some work, so we'll resume next week. And before the class, I will tell you whether I am going to share the slide beforehand or I will deliver a lecture. If I share a slide, then you are expected to go through the slide. And then during this lecture hours, we will have live interaction where you will get the opportunity to get clarifications on confusions that you may have. Is that all right? So, who is this Venkat Naga Sindhu? Can you give us the latest evaluation policy for the course? Means what?
Sir, in the slides you have mentioned that whatever evaluation that weightage is given, that is of last year. So, like, can you modify the slides to include the current policy? Yes.
Fine. Okay. So, what I said is that number of exams will be maximum 4, but most likely it will be 3, including mid-sem, end-sem, and one quiz. Last time it was probably more, if I remember correctly. Then other things will remain same. Interaction will carry good amount of weight. Last year it was 25%. Now, depending on first few classes, I may reduce it also if if everybody started interacting and everybody is not getting a chance to interact, which is unlikely as per my past experience. So other things will remain the same. That is, project implementation will carry 50% weight. Theory grade will be decided by exam plus interaction and will be influenced by your performance in the project to some extent. See, although I said that this theory grade and lab grade will be separate, and then it will be one is exam plus interaction, other one is project plus interaction, but there will be some influence of one on the other. So, but then performed well in the theory exam and to a reasonable extent, but did nothing in the project, then that will affect your grade in the theory also. You are expected to maintain a balance. Okay. But there will be no viva as such, lab viva or anything, because it is difficult in online mode. Other things are same as what I have shown. Does that answer your question? Chittala, yes. Venkata, Nagasin. Okay. Fine. So if there is no more question, then we can stop here. And we will resume our classes next week. Same time slot. Meanwhile, we'll circulate that Excel file. I think some form or something where you are requested to put in your team details. So form teams of 4 members. Only one team can have 5 members. Other teams will be having 4 members. So form it, and once we circulate this form, put in the details. Okay, that's all for today. See you next week.